So the morning's panel topic is extraterritorial application of U.S. law, and this is a topic that's been lurking in a number of the discussions yesterday, so today we get to confront it head-on, and our panel brings a wealth of experience to the subject. Jennifer Daskal is an assistant professor of law at American, and from 2009 to 2011, she was counsel to the assistant attorney general for the National Security Division at the Justice Department. And prior to that, she was a senior counterterrorism counsel at Human Rights Watch. Peter Swire is a professor of law and ethics at Georgia Tech. He advised two sitting presidents on privacy issues. He served on President Obama's review group on intelligence and communications technology. And he also served as President Clinton's chief counselor for privacy. And he's also a senior fellow for the Future of Privacy Forum and a policy fellow at the Center for Democracy and Technology. Andrew Woods is an assistant professor of law at University of Kentucky, and he's the author of a report on data beyond borders. He was also a postdoctoral cybersecurity fellow at Stanford. And Michael Farbiarz is going to be our commenter on the papers today. He's a senior fellow at the Center on Law and Security here at NYU, and also at the Center on the Administration of Criminal Law here at NYU. He was an AUSA for over a decade, and he served as the co-chief of the Terrorism and International Narcotics Unit of SDNY. So thanks so much for being here, and Jennifer's going to start us off.
So thanks to NYU, thanks to Zachary, thanks to Kathy for a really terrific conference. It was a great day yesterday, and I look forward to today as well. So I'm going to start with the Microsoft case, partially because I'm surprised it didn't come up at all yesterday, except for a very brief mention, and partially because it's what got me interested in this topic. So just to recap, as I'm sure all of you here know, in December 2013, the government served a warrant on Microsoft demanding that it turn over, among other things, emails that were associated with a particular account. And Microsoft said no, that the emails were located in Dublin, that this was an extraterritorial search, and that therefore the magistrate based in New York lacked jurisdiction to order their production. The government fought back. It said what mattered was the location of Microsoft, not the data itself. And as long as Microsoft is based in the United States, which it obviously is, and as long as Microsoft could access the data from the United States, which it could, that this was a territorial, not an extraterritorial action. The territorial action was the compulsion of Microsoft. And both the magistrate and the district court sided with the government in the cases now, as I'm sure you all know, before the Second Circuit. So I start with this case because I think it's an excellent example of the many ways in which data challenges what I call territoriality doctrine, the long-standing dividing line between the rules governing territorial searches and seizures and the rules governing extraterritorial searches and seizures. And to give you the punchline up front, my argument is that data's, what I call data's unterritoriality, poses a fundamental challenge to territorial doctrine itself, but that the challenge requires slightly different answers depending on the context. So I want to briefly do three things. I want to explain the territorial-based presumptions underlying the Fourth Amendment and law enforcement jurisdiction. I want to highlight the ways in which data challenges those presumptions, and I want to provide some tentative answers. So as I think everyone here also knows, the law is rife with territorial-based presumptions, not just with respect to the areas I'm talking about today, the Fourth Amendment and law enforcement jurisdiction, but in a host of other areas as well, including canons of statutory instruction. We talked about this a little bit yesterday afternoon with respect to human rights law as well. And in fact, the idea of a territorial constitution was so prevalent with respect to constitutional rights that it was not even until 1957, not that long ago, that the Supreme Court first concluded that core constitutional rights, in this case, the Fifth and the Sixth Amendment jury trial rights, clearly protected U.S. citizens, even U.S. citizens abroad. And while the Supreme Court's never explicitly addressed the extraterritorial scope of Fourth Amendment rights as is applied to U.S. citizens, it's widely assumed, and several lower courts have said so, that citizens retain their Fourth Amendment rights wherever they are located, although the location and the context continues to affect how these Fourth Amendment rights are applied. And conversely, thanks to the Supreme Court's splinter decision in 1990 in Verdugo-Urquidez, it is now widely understood that non-citizens located outside the nation's borders lack Fourth Amendment rights unless they develop substantial voluntary connections to the nation. So the weight of authority now assumes two basic things. Fourth Amendment applies and restricts government activity within the United States, but it imposes no restrictions when the government acts outside of the United States unless it's acting upon a U.S. citizen or a non-citizen with substantial voluntary connections to the United States. Now, relatedly, but analytically distinct to the reach of the Fourth Amendment is the question of the reach of magistrate judges' warrant authority. And this is a very different question. I can't emphasize this enough. This is a very different question than the question about the scope of individual rights protections, which in the context of the Fourth Amendment is a question about what constraints, if any, apply to the government when it searches and seizes. Warrant jurisdiction, by contrast, is a question about where magistrate judges can authorize the government to search and seize. So it's a very different inquiry. And when we're talking about such affirmative authorizations, long-standing principles of international law come into play and they loom large. Principles that are based on respect for state sovereignty and therefore prohibit states from unilaterally exercising law enforcement jurisdiction in another state without that state's consent. This is known as the principle of non-intervention. And so given these principles, the federal rules of criminal procedure do not, outside of very narrow circumstances, authorize the issuance of warrants with extraterritorial reach. We talked about this a little bit yesterday in connection with our discussion of Rule 41 and the proposed amendments. And it's also widely accepted that the Stored Communications Act, which is the relevant statute in the Microsoft case, does not have extraterritorial reach. In fact, I think this is one of the few points of agreement between the government and the Microsoft case, and Microsoft in the Microsoft case, they just disagree as to what's territorial and what's extraterritorial. So to sum up, territorial doctrine as applied to the Fourth Amendment and law enforcement jurisdiction serve two very different purposes. In the context of the Fourth Amendment, it is a proxy for the idea that only certain persons fall within the class of the people entitled to the Fourth Amendment protections. And in the context of warrant jurisdiction, it reflects the understanding that nations cannot exercise unilateral law enforcement jurisdiction in another nation without their consent. That said, in both areas, territoriality, whatever the underlying purpose, depends on there being a very well-defined and stable understanding of what's here and what's there, clarity about what's territorial and what's extraterritorial. And this brings me to my second claim, that data is raising fundamental questions, fundamental challenges to our understanding of what's here and what's there, and therefore to territorial doctrine itself. And traditionally, this is because territoriality under the Fourth Amendment and also under questions surrounding law enforcement jurisdiction have turned on the location of the property being searched and seized. And this presumes that there is an ability to identify the location of the property and that that location has some sort of normative significance, generally an association with and often a conscious choice on behalf of the property owner to associate with a particular place. And so data, I think, fundamentally challenges these presumptions in another number of ways. And I'm going to briefly describe this in kind of three big groupings: the mobility and divisibility of data, the location independence of data and the government agent or official accessing the data, and its intermingling. So the mobility and divisibility of data. When physical objects travel from place to place, they generally go a regular direct route absent some conscious choice to detour. And when I store my diary in a safety deposit box, I pick the location and I generally expect it to stay there as long as I retain the key. Not so with data. When I send an email to my parents in Chicago, it may go directly from DC to Chicago, it may bounce through New York, it may bounce to the UK. Similarly, and with respect to the topic of conference for purposes of this conference, when I store my data in the cloud, it moves around. It may be copied and backed up in multiple locations. My account may even be divided and stored on multiple servers. Moreover, I, as the user, generally do not have any idea where my data is located at any given moment, or the path it takes when it transits from place to place. This data location determination is delegated to third parties, the ISPs and the cloud service providers, not generally the choice of the user, him or herself. And this matters for two reasons. First, it highlights the arbitrariness of data location as determinative of the rules that apply. And second, it raises questions about the underlying assumption that the place where data is located has any normative significance. If I don't choose, and I might not even know the location of my data, why should I be bound by the rules of the host nation? And conversely, why should privacy protections vary based on where one's ISP or cloud service provider chooses to keep one's data? So this then brings me to my second category, the location disconnect of data and the government agent accessing the data, which allows agents to access data remotely as the government's asking Microsoft to do in the pending case, or as the government might do directly itself. And this distinction is what I think is opening up the space for the kind of argument that we see made in the Microsoft case, that it's the location of the relevant government actor and not the location of the data itself that matters. And I want to be clear that it's not just the US government that's making this argument. The UK, for example, has recently passed legislation that would authorize law enforcement agents to compel data associated with the target of a particular investigation, regardless of where it's located. And you could also imagine other nations doing this as well, say China, Russia, a number of other nations following suit. And this raises questions about the United States being able to protect data within its own boundaries to the extent that that remains a priority for the United States. Finally, there's the issue of intermingling. Communications, by definition, have at least one sender, one recipient, sometimes multiple recipients. Some may be based territorially, some may be based extraterritorially, some may be US citizens, some may not be. Email often travels in multi-communication transactions with multiple discrete communications bundled together. And this yields what we've talked about also yesterday, large quantities of what's known as incidental collection, when, for example, the government targets a non-citizen located overseas that lacks Fourth Amendment rights, yet acquires a whole host of information that's to or from a US citizen that is entitled to Fourth Amendment rights. Now again, this is not a new problem, but the quantity of information being collected, particularly pursuant to foreign surveillance authorities, which I'm not talking about today, makes it a problem that needs to be addressed. And my concern is that restrictive rules governing access to US person information become somewhat meaningless or at least significantly watered down if the same information can be, and in fact is, being gathered as incidental collection. All right, I'm gonna be really quick because I'm running out of time. All right, so what does this all mean? I'm gonna tell you what it means in two minutes. I have 2 minutes, all right. So let's start with the Fourth Amendment. My argument is that data's unterritoriality calls into question a territorial Fourth Amendment and does so for two reasons. First, there's the simple arbitrariness of making data location determinative of whether an individual is protected by the US Constitution, given what we know about the way data transits the globe. But second, and more importantly, and this is my more important message, given the potential breadth of incidental collection, a territorial Fourth Amendment fails to provide the kind of protection that it is meant to the people that it is intended to cover, at least at the acquisition stage. The intermingling of US person and non-US person means that a territorial Fourth Amendment is falling on its own terms. It's failing to serve its intended purpose of protecting the people. And I therefore call what I'm labeling an unterritorial Fourth Amendment, and I'm happy to explain more what I mean about that in the question and answer period. Similarly, when we turn to the Microsoft case, I think that the government's argument in the Microsoft case is persuasive, that it's increasingly arbitrary for the government access to data to turn on where data happens to be at any given moment. That said, as I argue in my paper and I've also blogged about, I think that Microsoft ought to win this case, that ultimately access ought to turn on things other than location, but that we need to be careful about how we get there. And while the government's approach in the Microsoft case responds to the legitimate concerns about the arbitrariness of data location, it runs headlong into some of the very values that a territorial warrant jurisdiction is meant to protect: respect for sovereignty and respect for the principle of non-intervention, and that this has real potential costs. It has costs in terms of our ability to protect data within our own borders. It has costs in terms of the way it fuels data localization movements, and we can talk about that more. It has huge costs to business interests in the United States, which matters, but even more importantly, it potentially has costs to internet efficiency if we start seeing data localization movements really taking off. And so I argue that we ought to address the government's concerns as expressed in the Microsoft case, but do so in a way that respects countervailing interests, ideally through some sort of new in an ideal world, we would come up with some sort of new supranational global warrant system that would allow government agents to access data without respect to where it's located at any given moment. I recognize that that is a bit of a utopian long-term project, and I have lots of other thoughts about what we should take as intermediate steps before we get there. So I will stop there. I think I'm over time, and thanks.
Tech folks, let's see, do I have a way to actually get my slides up? Well, that's one thing, but the problem is I have no idea how to get to my slides. Kathy, I've sent them, they said it was ready. What? No, I sent them to the people, they told me they were now. Sorry. I was assured that these were received and ready, and I didn't.
Do you want to switch the order?
Sure, it's fine. Okay. Yeah, see something that says MY? Sorry.
Then
you just need to go to the full side. Okay, thanks. First of all, thanks to NYU, and I'm sorry that I've got laryngitis today. I don't think it's the topic, I just think it's something that happened. So this is a project on MLATs, Mutual Legal Assistance Treaties. I have a draft paper that just got done a week ago, and it's the first draft, so I decided not to put it out to the world quite yet. If you want to contact me, Peter at peterswire.net, or find me on the web, I'll send it to you. So this is an ongoing research and law reform project, and it builds on MLAT discussions in the President's Review Group on Intelligence and Communications Technology that I was part of. We met with a variety of civil society and companies and others and had a series of recommendations on MLATs, which I think has helped get more attention to this previously obscure issue. In the paper and in the talk, briefly I'll talk about the importance of MLATs after Snowden, some short and medium term reforms, and some longer term reforms. And by the way, can you hear me in the back? It's sort of set weird timbre, but there you go. Okay, and I'm gonna talk about an analogy to something called the Visa Waiver Program as a perhaps interesting model for future changes. So why does this matter now? Well, technology's changed, all of us know that. We all at some level know there's a transborder cyber crime and cybersecurity problem. And so imagine there's a German victim and German criminals, but emails about those activities and other records might be in the US. So if you're the German police, you need records in the United States. And that's MLATs traditionally, you ask for help from the United States. Another thing is a paper that Ira Rubenstein hosted a conference a couple of years ago, and I gave a paper in 2012 about how growing use of encryption drives law enforcement to seek records in the cloud. Using MLATs typically. And the reason is today we use HTTPS and other encryption to send our webmail, many other communications, our social networking, et cetera. When it's encrypted, local wiretaps stop working. Local cops get a wiretap on the bad guy or the suspect. They do the wiretap, they get zeros and ones, nothing happens. They say, what can we do? Let's get plain text. Where's the plain text? It's in the cloud, it's in Redmond, it's in Mountain View, it's wherever it is. And so the combination of international activities and growing encryption drastically increases the likelihood you'll need MLATs to happen. What's the policy relevance of that? Policy relevance is complaints about MLATs partly are a big symbol of EU frustration after Snowden. They're really frustrated with the US and surveillance, and they can't even get the evidence they need. It gets the governments exercised. Slow MLATs, as Jen was in some ways pointing to a minute ago, are an excuse for data localization laws, right? Because if you can't get if you need to go to the US for the records, let's make sure the records are held here in Germany, here in Russia, whatever. And if nation states are frustrated with obstacles to law enforcement, then you might want a nation state-centered internet governance structure like the International Telecommunications Union. Internet folks know how much that's anathema to most US government, technology, and civil society people. So if we don't fix MLATs, we're risking giving power to ITU-like structures. Another reason to care about MLATs, how many people here have followed Apple and Google and device encryption? You've seen that, only about half, at least were willing to raise their hands this early in the morning. So Apple and Google have said we're not going to hand master keys over to FBI Director Comey and his people. There's a big fight about whether those keys should be required or pushed on the companies. If you have more efficient MLATs, you don't need the device quite so much because, again, you can get the stuff in the cloud. You might not get everything, but you get a lot of it. And so this is at least a partial answer to the frustration that UK Prime Minister Cameron and FBI Director Comey have expressed. So I think these matter a lot. What should we do about it, short and medium term? We had a series of recommendations in the review group report. First one, most obvious, brain dead, passed the House. The administration supports it. Got stuck in the Senate. Whoever heard of that happening? We should have more funding for the Department of Justice, especially the Office of International Affairs. That's who does the MLATs. We estimated something like an average of 10-month backlog. Imagine you're the cop. You just want to figure out who's connected to who. You wait 10 months for it. Trail goes cold. Very frustrating. If you have more people to process it, it will help. One that was sort of slightly outlined in the review group and that the paper talks about more is how to streamline the number of steps in the MLAT request process. And the idea here is to create a rocket docket, probably in DC. You have all the Department of Justice prosecutors who get good at it. You have all the magistrates who get good at it. You actually have one place where these things get done. And law reform in 2009 means we can do nationwide service of process. So we get a set of expert people doing this every day. We can staff it, we can pay for it, it helps a lot. I think that's a promising one. There's a variety of transparency in online forms and processing. We should do all these things to sort of help today's process work faster, better, cheaper. But working faster, better, cheaper when you're facing orders of magnitude is a recipe for failure. So usually what you do then is you need to re-engineer. You have to come up with some structure that's something faster than running the hamster wheel faster. And so the suggestion here, I have other suggestions in the paper, the one I'm going to focus on in limited time, is the analogy to the visa waiver program. So as you know, with globalization, it used to be everybody in the UK had to come get a visa interview to come to the United States. And today that's not true. Today for the UK and 37 other countries, what you want to do if you come to the United States for 90 days or less is you automatically get a visa unless there's evidence that you're a risky kind of person. So for nations with excellent procedures and visas, we waive the individual interview. Congress oversees these other countries to make sure they're doing the right job. The executive branch makes annual fundings to make sure each country is playing by the rules. And we still have strict rules when we think there's problems. So this is an actual working example of shifting the rules in the face of globalization. Lots of people travel. We need a streamlined, re-engineered procedure. Lots of data travels, lots of emails travel, we can have streamlined, globalized procedures to handle the higher volume. So that's comforting. Instead of this being some novel problem we've never solved before, we can almost copy the visa waiver provisions is the idea. What would that mean applied to MLATs? Well, one law professor, a former government official, doesn't have all the answers how to do this, but I hope to be working with a variety of folks on a stakeholder process. Here's what will go into it. So if any of you have papers to write, you know, you can all, you know, help to solve the world's problems. How do you develop safeguards analogous to the visa waiver program so that the streamlined MLAT process is proper, so that it goes really fast for the easy ones, it stops and notices the ones that are problematic? How do you intersect with Electronic Communications Privacy Act reform? ECPA reform, digital due process folks are saying we need a warrant for everything. Almost no foreign requests have a warrant. We have to figure out how we're going to do ECPA reform, which I and many others support, and do it in a way where we can intersect with the rest of the world. That work hasn't been done. I talk to people in this area, they say, I don't want to go there. We've got ECPA, let's do that first. Let's not worry about the intersections. You can't ignore it if you're going to do MLAT reform. A big project that yesterday's people would love to go on to is what counts as reasonable under the Fourth Amendment. When is a German procedure, a Dutch procedure, whatever, rule of law, very good lawyers, all that kind of stuff, when is it reasonable for them to follow their procedures and that be considered good enough to get records in the United States? If you're a Fourth Amendment absolutist, need a warrant for everything, really hard to deal with the rest of the world. We just won't be able to do it. So how do we think about what reasonableness means in that setting, probably without traditional warrants or by changing somehow what a warrant means? And one possibility in that direction is for the German victim, the example I was saying, for German criminals, we could imagine comedy. We could imagine deferring in some ways to our allied, very well set up country, and we could have standards matching German law rather than the US law. How much is that a model that makes sense? Right, it's basically a German crime, but some of the records are here, but if they meet the German standards, can they get the records here, and how would we do the handoff in a way that we trust? So last slide. I hope that this taste about MLATs suggests to you that this is an important issue. There is and will be huge growth in cross-border evidence and evidence requests, especially because of growing encryption where the records are held in other places. To avoid localization, destruction of the internet, the end of all things good in life, we should do the short-term reforms that we said, get the funding going and do the rocket docket, and we should come up with a process that we are developing for workable long-term reforms. If you're interested in this process or if you want to comment on the draft paper, let me know. I hope this will be the thing that I'm working on a lot over the next couple of years, and it's obviously not a one-person thing. So, having ways to fix this international legal Fourth Amendment-related project could also help us avoid or reduce localization, avoid or reduce some of the pressures for the ITU. Seems worth doing. So thanks for your attention.
I'll sit here so you can't see it. I'm wearing Bermuda shorts. So thanks so much for having me here. As Daphna mentioned, I wrote on. Can you hear me? It says on. Can everybody hear me? Thanks. So as Daphna mentioned, I wrote a report about MLATs for the Global Network Initiative, which is
cited extensively in my draft paper.
And thanks. which was written for the Global Network Initiative, which is one of the multi-stakeholder groups that Mike Posner was talking about yesterday. It's a consortium of major tech companies and major civil society organizations concerned about the future of the internet. I'm working on a paper now that I think actually bridges very much what Jen is working on and what Peter is working on. And so what I want to do today is just say a few words about the connection between their projects and mine. So I'll make three quick points. The first is that this is all part of the same system. Jen's concern with territoriality and Peter's concern with international cooperation are just two different pieces of the same system, although I think both of them could acknowledge that more than they do. The second point I want to make is that some of the worst threats to the internet today, as both Jen and Peter mentioned, can be linked to the fact that the international cooperation regime for government access to data is fundamentally broken. And then finally, I'll say a quick word about what we ought to do about all of this. If you want to duck out for the next 15 minutes, the bottom line short version is I think we should fix the system we have rather than devise a new one. I'm happy to say more about that later. Okay, so the first point really is a congratulations to the people who organized this panel, because I don't think it's obvious if you were to read Jen's paper or read Peter's paper that you would think that they belonged on the same panel, but I really think they do belong on the same panel, so kudos to the organizers. Jen is writing about this jurisdictional problem of locating data. It's a real problem. And Peter is writing about international cooperation, specifically MLATs. But that is a process that only kicks in after states acknowledge that there are limits to their jurisdiction over data, right? So essentially, Jen is working on the scope of a state's authority over data. And then if the data lies outside that scope, the states jump into the MLAT process that Peter is writing about. And I want to show how these are two parts of the same system. And in fact, they're not just linked, but they're hydraulically related to each other. I can't say the word hydraulic without smiling. This is a small side note. When I was a fellow preparing to go on the job market, my colleagues and I had a running joke about the fact that it seemed that every job talk paper had the word hydraulic in it. So we made a bet to see if we could all put hydraulic in our job talks. And I want to just keep that dream alive today. So. But this really is a hydraulic system, and let me just explain why. So states want data, and sometimes for not so great reasons, but sometimes for really legitimate reasons. They want data for all kinds of things, criminal investigations, intelligence gathering, administrative matters, and much, much more. The first hurdle to getting that data is asserting jurisdiction over it, right? That's natural enough. That's a big piece of Jen's project. If the data is in their jurisdiction, however defined, it's theirs, and they don't need international cooperation to get it. However, if they acknowledge the data is outside their jurisdiction, then they have to ask whoever has jurisdiction over the data to compel it, and that's Peter's project. So the first point is just at a descriptive level, these two things are deeply linked. And then the second point that I want to make is to explain why it matters that they're linked and that the harms in Peter's system can cause harms for Jen's problems, and the problems Jen's writing about can cause harms in Peter's world. I won't say much more than Peter just did about the problem with international cooperation as it stands now. You can look at my report for more on this or Peter's paper. Suffice it to say, MLATs are slow, opaque, and inefficient. If you're a cop in another country trying to get access to data in the US, you don't want to use the MLAT process. That may seem like a good thing. If you care about privacy as I do, your first reaction might be, gee whiz, what's bad about a process that makes it hard for cops to get access to data? There's too much of that going around. I'm happy with a system that slows those cops down. That view, I want to say, is deeply misguided and naive. And it's wrong because of my first point that these two systems are linked. That is, when states can't get data they seek through international cooperation, through MLAT, they do a bunch of really nasty things. The first is that they expand their territorial reach. That's Jen's problem. So you've seen this in the US in the Microsoft Ireland case, you see this in the UK. It's a growing problem. States look at the MLAT process and they say, we don't want to touch that with a 10-foot pole, let's just claim that that data is within our jurisdiction. You can imagine how hard it would be for a company to operate globally if every country in the world claimed that their laws applied to that company's data, right? It doesn't take much imagination to see that no company can comply with all countries' laws at the same time, right? Because laws conflict. The second thing that states do that's really nasty, because the MLAT process, or largely because the MLAT process doesn't work, is demand data localization. That is, store some data in our soil so that we can get it. Both Peter and Jen mentioned this. This is hugely costly. It poses a serious challenge to the internet as we know it. If we want a global internet, and I posit that we do, then this is really a bad idea, and localization should be opposed. Another thing states do that's pretty nasty because they can't get the data they want, partly because of the MLAT process is broken, is they arrest the employees of tech firms. Ask Google employees in Brazil or Uber employees in Paris about this, and they'll tell you it's not very fun, it interrupts their operations, it's bad for customers, it's bad for the companies. The last thing that countries do because the MLAT process doesn't work is surveil their citizens. So I would suggest that if your initial reaction looking at the MLAT process, which is broken, is gee whiz, that's great, you should realize that states will do much, much worse things because they can't get access to the data that they're seeking through the MLAT process, like monitoring their citizens. I was at a conference in DC a couple of months ago. This is a conference it's one of the leading conferences for telecommunications providers that's been dubbed by some as the wiretapper's ball because it also serves as an exhibition for commercial companies that are selling commercial surveillance products. And while I was there, I was at lunch, I wandered around to one of the exhibition halls to talk to some of the companies selling these surveillance products, and I talked to one company that I won't mention, that I won't name, that sells a product that cops can install on phones to capture data before that data gets transmitted into an encrypted pipeline. So someone's typing on the Gmail app, the cops can sniff all that information out before it gets encrypted. So Peter's concerns about encryption don't arise. You get the data directly on the phone. I asked this guy, who's just a salesman for this company, have you ever heard of the MLAT process? And he said, with a thick accent, we love MLATs. Cops can't, the MLAT process is broken, so cops come to us and they say, we need your software. And I said, oh wow, MLATs are broken and that's causing cops to do illegal surveillance. And he said, no, it's not illegal. That's the thing. It's legal surveillance. This, say that there's an Italian cop who's trying to get access to data. The Italian government's view is that data is rightfully ours. The cop goes to the judge says, yes, you can get that data. And the company says, no, you can't get that data because that data is stored in California or Washington. You need a US warrant before we will hand over the data. So the cop says, screw that, I'm not gonna use the MLAT process. I don't need a US warrant. That's not what my judge said. So they go and install this software on the phone. So that's a scarier thought to me even than illegal surveillance, that people, there's such confusion about where data lies and who has authority over it, that people are surveilling lawfully, according to them, to get access to data that they can't get through the MLAT process. Okay, final point, which I'm not gonna be able to fully satisfy you on, is what do we do about this? If you agree with my earlier points, you'll see that we must tackle both, on the one hand, the state jurisdictional problem, over data that, as Jen has pointed out, doesn't easily fit within territorial borders, and then two, this international cooperation system Just on the second question of international cooperation, Peter raised a number of the really compelling short-term things that we could try to do. I just want to emphasize one very, very high-level picture point, which is that I think we ought to emphasize fixing the system we have rather than trying to build a new system. Whether that new system is a private clearinghouse for governments getting access to data that lies beyond their jurisdiction, or that is a brand new international treaty for government access to data, the kinds of things that Jen was talking about, I think, are a red herring when it comes to MLAT reform for a number of reasons. The first is that a new international regime is unlikely to occur at all, I think, and it will occur, but in order to reach agreement, it will represent such a compromise that it will not be a meaningful improvement over the existing process. And some people say, okay, well, in response to that, then we'll just build a really meaningful, really great international regime, but only with like-minded states. And I think that is actually possible, but the problem is that doesn't solve the bulk of the problems that we currently face with the MLAT regime. Brazil's not going to be a part of it, China's not going to be a part of it, and those are really important players in this, in fixing this. Let me just stop here, and I'm happy to talk more about this in the Q&A, but I just want to emphasize that I think the biggest problem with building a new international regime is that it would allow states to delay making improvements to the current MLAT regime, because they can say, oh, why should we invest new money, as Peter suggests, at OIA, at DOJ, to handle MLAT requests, when what we really need is a new international treaty. I think the international treaty is a red herring that gets in the way of meaningful and possible reforms. Thank you.
That was hydraulic, I think. I'm going to limit myself to 10 minutes, which is tight for three excellent projects. And to make that happen, I'll try and make one comment about each, and in the hopes that instead of just saying how great they are, that it can stoke some conversation, I'll hope to make a critical comment, one about each of the various projects. And starting with Peter's, if I might, you know, there's this whole world we live in of post-Snowden, and there's a narrative of what has happened after Snowden with respect to data localization. It's a story that we all know, I think. It is that people kind of look around at the new world they've seen, and they say, God, the U.S. is gobbling up everyone's data. And they're taking the data and they're looking at it themselves, or maybe they're giving it to the German police or the French police or whoever, and my privacy rights, interest, what have you, are threatened. And because of that, we all believe there's this danger of data localization. People are not gonna wanna ship their data through a United States internet service provider. That's a conventional account, and I think it's one we all believe in. Peter's paper provides what I think is a deeply unconventional account, and one that in some ways is directly antithetical to the conventional account. Peter says, look, the MLAT process is broken, meaning that you know, the U.S. is being asked to provide certain information from U.S. internet service providers, the U.S. government, and it's not doing it. It's not doing it fast enough. And because of dissatisfaction with that, there's going to be data localization. And to solve the problem, what Peter proposes, he talks about the visa waiver program. I think it's fair to say that what Peter is proposing is a drastic lowering of Fourth Amendment protections below what everyone would understand is today's law. So we have two very different pictures. The conventional account is people fear U.S. gobbling up of data, people fear loss of privacy, and that leads to data localization. Peter presses the exact opposite argument, which is to say there is not enough gobbling up of data by the United States, and the solution in many ways is a reduction in privacy within the borders of the United States. I would say two things. One of them is I at least was persuaded by the conventional account. I nodded along to all the articles that I read over the last 18 months about how, ooh, Snowden might lead to data localization because people fear loss of privacy. I need to know more to be persuaded by Peter's account that because a police officer in Holland doesn't feel like he or she is getting a fast enough turnaround on an MLAT request, there's going to be data localization in Europe. But more is at stake, I would think, than kind of figuring out which of these stories is correct, because they can't live together. Because if the conventional story is right, well, Peter's story can't be right. And if Peter's story is right, fixing the problem in the way he describes, hurrying along MLATs, the U.S. gobbling up more data and more quickly, and doing it in a way that explicitly lowers privacy rights with a visa waiver program analogy, that is only going to exacerbate the post-Snowden data localization urge that the conventional story has. So that's a quick comment, maybe to be addressed in a moment by Peter. Quick thought about Andrew and Peter's shared project. It starts from the idea that the MLAT process is broken. And there are a couple of data points on that. One of them is the idea that, there's the expanded reach of MLATs is there's this whole world where countries are doing things like the Microsoft case because the MLAT system is broken. I'm not sure if that's historically right. The Walsh Act, which permits subpoenaing of U.S. citizens abroad or U.S. companies abroad, that's from 1934. The first MLAT dates from the mid-70s. I think this is a pretty long-standing issue that long predates any dissatisfaction with MLATs, which is, say, the problem of subpoenaing U.S. companies, for their records abroad. More fundamentally, when you say a system is broken, it's hard to know what baseline one is operating from. I think it's unbelievable, I agree, that the average turnaround for MLATs is 10 months. But what I hear in the papers is, let's make that 10 hours. I would say to you, ask a prosecutor and FBI agent how long it takes Verizon in a murder investigation to hand over phone records. In the United States, it can take weeks and weeks and weeks. Now, that's not 10 months.
Is that the standard?
I don't know what the standard is. I do know that with internet service providers, the standard move is horrible non-compliance, search warrants, subpoenas, what have you. There is a background culture of jawboning of internet service provider employees to try and get them to hurry things along and comply with judicial deadlines. It's a long way of saying, if the MLAT system is broken, it may not be because of anything particular to the MLAT system. It may be something larger that is familiar from human life, which is, we care about the things that matter to us, but not so much the things that matter to someone else. When a country gets a request from another country, the first country, the receiving country, have a lot of things on their plate. Those prosecutors and that Department of Justice is trying to stop a lot of bad things and accomplish some important things. And someone else's important thing is someone else's important thing. And the same thing is true for Verizon or for a Bell company or for an internet service provider. I understand the not staffing up in a large way of a subpoena compliance unit. If that is the case, if what we're talking about is one incident of the standard human problem of people care about their own stuff more than other people's, then the solution is probably not going to be a better mousetrap. The solution to slow MLAT stuff, the solution is probably going to be some rough approximation of what we have now, which is, you get a stack of things this high, and people have credibility because they're repeat players, and sometimes you pick up the phone and say, that subpoena you got today, there's a child in a trunk, and I need this now. And Peter invoked the example of what happened in Paris in Charlie Hebdo, and it only took one day. It took one day because people who are responsible repeat players say, I know you're swamped. I know my stuff doesn't matter as much to you as yours does to you. This one matters more. So it's a long way of saying that there is a mousetrap solution. There is a funding solution. But the way these things, I think, in general work is that personal relationships and repeat players try to move things to the top of a pile, often not so successfully, but I think it's a background fact that's not particular to the MLAT context.
How am I doing, 10 minutes?
Ooh, good. Okay, so quick comment, if I might, on Professor Daskal's paper, and all of these projects are just wonderful. you know, I think that what she argues at great length is, look, data is different, data is unterritorial, it's free-flowing, everything is different, and when data randomly passes through the United Kingdom, when Professor Daskal's emailing her parents in Chicago, that's just fortuitous, it doesn't matter. I hear that, but if that's the case, I think we have to ask ourselves two things. One, if the location of data is truly fortuitous, why is Ireland getting worked up? And why do we invoke concepts like sovereignty and non-intervention if it's all just a kind of random happenstance? Why do countries seem to care about this? Query if they do. And B, if they do care about it, why do we care about it? I mean, if we're on board with what Professor Daskal says, that it's zeros and ones that are flowing around the world in a random way, I'm not sure that what's really at stake when one country asks for, you know, the Professor Daskal's email to her mom is in the UK. I don't know why the UK even cares if it's asked about that, if it has no connection to the email, to the person, et cetera. A second thing is, but closely related, I hope, is, you know, the idea that data is different. Look, I have some doubts about that. I mean, data is somewhat different. Looks a lot like bank records have looked for a long time. Bank records are copied in a lot of different countries. When I do banking, I know when I take money out of my corner bank, I know it's not actually sort of only being handled there. Some of the discussions in personal jurisdiction cases or tort cases sound a lot like the data cases. A car manufacturer says, wait, which of the 50 states' laws am I subject to when you drive this car around in the United States? How am I supposed to know where you're taking the car? These are problems that I don't know are totally particular to data. They seem in some ways not fully standard, but familiar. Example is the remote access issue that was mentioned. You know, we mentioned the Walsh Act a moment ago. There are Supreme Court cases from the 1950s about what I think of as this very remote access issue, which is asking somebody to produce records that are in a foreign country. I don't know if this is a function of zeros and ones so much as a background fact of a big world with a diversity of laws. I think more fundamentally, at least for me, I wasn't too sure I understood how the Fourth Amendment payout worked, which is to say there's this very powerful argument that data is different and it has implications, we're told, for how we handle all these crucial doctrines, one of which is the Fourth Amendment. But to me, where we land is with the current Fourth Amendment. I think that I hope I'm not misunderstanding it, but I think where we land is the Fourth Amendment certainly applies in the United States. And okay, so that is the territorial Fourth Amendment that is on territoriality might challenge. And then outside of the United States, it applies to US people, which the various circuit courts have all said. And I think the difference is that unless you know for sure you're dealing with a non-US person, the Fourth Amendment is to apply. And that's different a bit than current law, but I'm not sure how different. I can't imagine too many courts that heard a case where the US says, look, there's a mail processing station in the Congo, and the United States just went in and searched and didn't know or care or pay attention to the citizenship of anyone whose mail was passing through. I think most courts, if confronted with that situation, outside of the foreign intelligence context where things are different as a matter of Fourth Amendment doctrine, I think they would say, yeah, that's not allowed, because there are these background rules of territoriality and citizenship identity, and to preserve them, you need to have some discernment between who's a citizen and who's not when you're outside of the United States. It's a long way of saying I don't know if what is being proposed is actually a remaking of Fourth Amendment law. It sounds to me a lot like Fourth Amendment law as it exists, but in a context where we don't see a lot of cases. They're all great papers, and thanks for being here.
I, I agree that they're all wonderful papers, and maybe a final comment to get the conversation started and to tease out some of the tensions between the papers, thinking along the lines of the goals, the mechanisms, and then some unintended consequences. Jen's paper, the goal is very express, which is more robust Fourth Amendment protections for U.S. persons. And I understand that goal to not be inconsistent with Peter and Andrew's project, although it's framed more from the concern of needing more effective international cooperation given data problems. But when we turn to the mechanisms, the papers seem to go in two pretty different directions. So it seems like Jen's project is, let's collapse the legal divide between U.S. persons and non-U.S. persons for purposes of domestic law. And Peter's project seems to take it in the opposite direction, which is in some ways to augment that legal divide so that what the U.S. government can do in the United States on behalf of another government looks different and in some ways looks more permissive than what the U.S. can do in the United States on behalf of itself. And then with both projects, that leads me to questions of unintended consequences. So with Jen's paper, I wonder if we're going to have a race to the bottom. So once we say the warrant clause applies always or not at all, are we just going to get, or and more broadly, the Fourth Amendment applies to data everywhere or not at all? Are we going to have a lowering of Fourth Amendment protections because of just the practical limitations of such a robust vision of where the Fourth Amendment can govern? And similarly, Peter, with your project and Andrew as well, I wonder to the extent that one of the ways that we reform the MLAT process is by making the legal restrictions that apply to the U.S. government not apply when the U.S. government is operating in the United States on behalf of another government. We're creating a real incentive for workarounds, a real incentive for the U.S. government to want to do on behalf of another government what it couldn't do on behalf of itself. And so, you know, those are some questions and concerns that I think any of the projects would have to grapple with, but they're really wonderful and important and get at the core of, I think, the issues that we're discussing over these 2 days. And do you guys want a chance to respond before we open it up?
Sure. I just want to respond first on the Fourth Amendment issue, and then slightly on the some of the other things that were raised. But just to respond specifically to what Michael said, I do think what I'm proposing is fairly radical. I don't think it's just a slight variation. What I'm saying is that it's a way of bringing incidental collection within the rubric of the Fourth Amendment. So you're right that historically, if a U.S. person was targeted overseas, of course the Fourth Amendment would apply. But what I'm now saying is that even if the target is a non-U.S. person, if there is a reason to believe, if there's even a suspicion that that person is also communicating with a U.S. person, that we should apply the Fourth Amendment in that context. And that's a very different way of thinking about the Fourth Amendment than I think we thought about traditionally. It brings in both this explicit target within the rubric of the Fourth Amendment and also the communicant to whom that person's talking to. And that is a big expansion of how we think about the Fourth Amendment. I think I agree that there is a risk when we start expanding our notion of the Fourth Amendment about standards being watered down and changing. I guess, and this has always been my perspective, I would rather be having that conversation and having that discussion about what is reasonable than just saying it doesn't apply at all. I would much rather be in that world than in the world of just assuming it doesn't apply. I have a lot more to say, but maybe I'll wait and come back to it later.
Well, sure. So I have a very brief statement, which is just that I agree, Michael, with your, or I did agree initially with the intuition that this really isn't all that different. And I think I might disagree with Jen about how different data is, as you pointed out. But the view that, yeah, it takes a long time for prosecutors to get the data they want in the U.S., and so if it takes a little longer for the international process to work, that doesn't strike me as so crazy. I don't think that that's going to be the official view of the U.S. government for very much longer. And I think what it's going to take to change it is Americans using a foreign-made app that stores data abroad. So the Microsoft Ireland case is a somewhat easier case because we're talking about an American company that happens to have stored some data abroad. But if all of us have on our cell phones an app that was made in China or Israel, and the data is for that related to that app is stored in China or Israel, I think the U.S. government is going to care a hell of a lot more than they do right now about the 10-month delay in the MLAT process.
So these were great questions. I'm going to do three, just tick, tick, tick. First is Daphna's, which is, won't there be an incentive for workarounds? If we let the Germans come in and get data on lower standards, won't that be a reason for people to do things they're not supposed to do by playing with the Germans? We have this in the intelligence world where NSA and GCHQ, you could imagine that NSA does all the surveillance in England and GCHQ does all the surveillance in the United States and then they hand it off to each other. That is clearly against US law, and based on what I've learned from my own work is the rules are followed. So that kind of handoff doesn't happen. There's skeptics in the world who think it does, but that's not my experience from what I've seen. So, and it's better to have these kinds of respect for other countries than for the US to say to the rest of the world, they have to create common law magistrates before they can get evidence, because I think that's a crazy way to go. In terms of Michael's great questions, just real quick, am I really lowering the Fourth Amendment and destroying privacy as we know it? slightly overstating, but that's the direction. So one point back to that is Andrew's point about how extra surveillance gets done in Italy if they can't get it through the MLAT process. So the cops are going to try to get their job done one place or another. Having working legal process is better than some of the other things we'd see. The other point that Michael asked is about the Snowden narrative has been the privacy people are scared about the U.S. after all this, and so that's going to lead to localization. What I would say is that my paper is highly consistent with that, which is if you take an interest group approach to how localization can happen, imagine you're a European country, you're a legislator. The privacy people come and say we have to be strict and localized so the U.S. can't look at it. The protectionist business people come saying we have to be strict so we can beat up on Microsoft and Google. And now the cops come and say, we can't stop local crime unless you localize. If you've got the cops, the privacy advocates, and business all on your side, that's a heck of a coalition. And so that's it's really worth seeing how risky it can be for that coalition to be in favor of localization and against the kind of internet we want. So reducing the reasons to allow localization seems worth doing. Yeah, the Office of International Affairs, or passes it on to the U.S. Attorney in whatever places. And then the U.S., what happens in the U.S., and a lot of times it's ECPA, not Fourth Amendment, that really bites. So, but what would happen is the Italian request comes in, goes to Washington, the OIA attorney says it looks good enough or not. If not, they bounce it back. If it's good enough, they ship it out to the district attorney, the U.S. Attorney's office. U.S. Attorney assigns it to an AUSA who has a pile like this, as Michael said. And when the AUSA gets to this one, they ask the company for the records. But it's a federal prosecutor who's going to get a court order from a U.S. federal judge. So there's a Fourth Amendment all over the place for the process in the United States.
Yeah, can I just add to that, too, that part of the problem with that process, there are many things that are troubling about that process, but one of them is that the company ultimately receives an order from a U.S. judge. So when they issue their transparency reports and they say, we've received demands from governments for data, they would count that as a US government demand for data, even though the US is making that demand on behalf of another government. So it not always. Sometimes judges try to make, there's an effort to be made to show that it was on behalf of another country via an MLAT, but it makes it very tricky to get an accurate picture, at least based on transparency reports from companies, about who's making requests for data. Oh, yeah. Yeah, they are. No, no.
They're a U.S. magistrate.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
And maybe just worth mentioning just one small thing. I think that there's two processes. There's a background common law letters revocatory process, and there's a statutory MLAT process. The question you're asking about how does conceptually does the Fourth Amendment bind a search that might be conducted by a non-U.S. government official is a hard question if prosecutors relied upon the background common law system, the letters revocatory system. They don't. They rely on the MLAT system, which is conventionally thought to be faster. The MLAT system is energized by a statute which tells magistrate judges that they can issue orders of the following kinds, non-inclusive it is said, of the following kinds based on a foreign request. And so prosecutors who look at that statute and say, okay, based on this statute, this MLAT can generate a search warrant, can generate a 2703 order, et cetera, et cetera. Prosecutors then prepare the same sort of application they would prepare based on the information supplied by a foreign government official. Without that statute, would there be a Fourth Amendment bar? That's an interesting question, but it's one that doesn't arise precisely because the statutory threshold is almost necessarily above the constitutional floor in that context.
Ira.
Right, I was. So here's a couple responses, and others may have insights. One is that the showing to the U.S. magistrate has to be probable cause and meet the ECPA and Fourth Amendment requirements. Italian police don't grow up getting educated in that. They file their, you know. And so there's this whole education, notice, whatever process to let foreign requesters learn what it takes to get past the U.S. prosecutor's screen before the U.S. prosecutor will take it to the magistrate. And that Italian process doesn't win unless it also meets the probable cause and ECPA requirements. And so for people who say, let's use a word out of safe harbor, something adequate, if you think Italy and Germany are adequate, good enough, not exactly the same as US because every country is different, you might think that adequate would be a good enough answer. But currently that hasn't been the way the US system has looked at it. And so merely getting the right kind of order from Italy or Germany is not enough to automatically trigger a yes from the United States. They have to independently decide if it meets the US standards. So basically, it's not good enough to be an Italian order. It has to also reach up to whatever the U.S. does.
Helen.
Thank you.
Yeah, let me just say, I don't know enough about how that works, because I don't think it's easy. I don't think that the cops can just install this software on anyone's phone whenever they want. But it is interesting. The point I just wanted to make is that the demand for surveillance, which is of a concern to some people, is connected to the demand for an international regime for sharing government-to-government access to data. Whether cops installing secret listening devices on phones is better or worse than going to the company to get access to the data in the cloud after the fact, that's a long debate.
Yes.
I just had a follow-up point, though, is that I don't think that this really goes to the bulk surveillance issue, right? Because the MLAT is also going to be targeted for some particular assessment. So, and if I wanted to do bulk surveillance, I'd have to install this thing on everybody's phone. So these are really two possible ways of getting at data in the target, right? Getting it.
Yours.
I have a question. It seems that a lot of the panelists have been speaking about solutions in terms of fixing things in the law enforcement space, but it seems to me that a lot of the problems are also happening in the field of national security and intelligence, government access, government data collection. And I was just wondering how that interface, like, how is that playing out?
I can take a try. So when we were writing the review group report, our task was around intelligence and not about law enforcement. And so there was this puzzle of how could we put the MLAT discussion into an intelligence report. and a bunch of lawyers sat down and we started writing. One way that I think about it is that we have exactly one internet to do a lot of things. We do law enforcement, we do intelligence, we look at cat videos, we do a lot of different things on the internet.
Mostly we watch cat videos.
Yeah, volume is clearly on the cat video side. And part of what's happening after Snowden and after the concerns about intelligence is there's a whole series of perturbations around the world that include ITU, internet governance, they include data localization. They include how much sort of putting rule of law and around the NSA is going to help fix those things or not. And I think that we came to the view that MLAT, partly for the reasons Michael asked about, which is that it gets into these mixes about data localization and the future structure of the internet, that MLATs actually are part of, we might almost get to use the word hydraulic, they're part of the overall ways that different countries are deciding how to be engaged with the internet and how to impose national laws on the internet. So I don't think that the law enforcement case-by-case sharing has a lot to do with how intelligence agencies share. They do that through their own sets of arrangements. But I think that MLATs is one of the places where these debates about sovereignty is happening and where some of the anger about the U.S. is being played out and anger about MLATs. So it's a more indirect kind of relationship.
If I can just add, the talk I gave is based on a larger paper where there's a section which I left out of what I talked about today that deals with foreign intelligence surveillance. And my argument about the Fourth Amendment also is analogous to what I say in that realm. So if you go back to when there was just traditional FISA in the United States, there was a determination after debate in Congress that the warrant wire requirement would apply to both to collection both of U.S. citizens and non-U.S. citizens, and there was a determination that was done in part to protect U.S. citizens. And so my argument that I make in the paper is that we ought to extend the same analogy when we're thinking of, we ought to have that same framework when we think about foreign intelligence collection now under FAA or under the expanded rules, and that we ought to eliminate this distinction between U.S. persons and non-U.S. persons. Doesn't make sense if ultimately we're trying to protect, and this is the parochial U.S. position, but if we're trying to protect U.S. person interests, we have to begin to eliminate these distinctions. Where that takes us, I don't necessarily know, and I don't address that in the paper, but at least at the collection stage, I think that those distinctions are no longer effectively serving the purpose that they're intending to promote.
Can I just add one other point to this, that all of us up here agree that intelligence collection and technology company data storage, these are hugely important issues. I just think this one is understudied. After Snowden, there was a ton of attention paid, scholarly public attention paid to intelligence collection and the laws related to intelligence collection and what kinds of reforms are needed, and almost no attention paid to law enforcement, the lawful mechanisms for law enforcement to get access to data. I mean, ask an average NYU student if they've heard of EO 12333 or any of the arcane things connected to intelligence gathering, and most of them or many of them will know about them. Ask them what an MLAT is, and almost none of them will know. I will just say that I agree, and I'm looking into it. I don't know enough about the current money, the global regime for managing how banks do business around the world to make a comprehensive statement about how that would map onto the MLAT data process. But I think it's something that needs to be looked into. Yeah.
What?
You might learn from the blockades. Yeah. You might learn from the, this way it works.
Yeah.
So
it's also a club.
So just three or four things on. So MLATs were started in part in reaction to cross-border financial crimes and the need for evidence and long-term investigations. Bank secrecy laws like Switzerland were a big battle about the U.S. wants to get the information. Switzerland says, no, you can't. We have conflicting laws. The poor bank stuck in the middle. So there's a long history in the banking side. And roughly speaking, the anti-money laundering push through the 90s and after the Patriot Act created an international regime where the data is grabbable across borders, and the U.S. has been very aggressive in using extraterritoriality for money laundering sorts of things. And in a debate I had with Andrew Weissman, who was on the panel yesterday, a few months ago, he was pointing to money laundering as a way of course we can do extraterritorial. It's been done for decades. Where these, the internet people don't realize how standard it is to be extraterritorial. So that's a view from the money laundering side.
Yeah, it's actually interesting that if you look at the briefs in the Microsoft trial, the U.S. government thinks that the regulation of the banking industry is, as Peter just said, the precedent for them being able to get access to records that are stored abroad. And Microsoft makes this, I think, elegant analogy to banking and says, it would be crazy for a New York cop to show up at a Bank of Switzerland branch in New York and say, hand us everything that you've got back in Switzerland, right? That would be a crazy attempt to grab stuff extraterritorially. So both sides are using the banking analogy to make the claim that they win, which suggest the analogy is not perfect.
And there's another piece of the distinction, which is that the normal, generally when there's the extraterritorial reach with respect to banking records, we're talking about the records themselves, or what is often considered the equivalent of what we've been talking about with respect to metadata.
Yeah.
And there's an argument that there's a real distinction between gathering information about what money was put in and how much, and that kind of metadata type information versus the content of communications.
The woman in the blue shirt.
So the interviews I've done with government officials is that electronic evidence is where a lot of the growth is, and each one tends to be much more time consuming. And so the pressure on the system's coming from the electronic side. So I think that's a great question. There's a lot of traditional kinds of things, and maybe bank records count, where the level of frustration has not been at the same level. I have no idea if it makes sense to apply it to electronic only if we go to the Visa Waiver Program. Great question.
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm agnostic about it too, but I would just want to be clear about the fact that if you look at the growth curve, I mean, I tried to get the number before I came here, but it's in the order of the tens of thousands, the number of requests the British government makes through MLAT every year. I mean, it's just insane. And the growth curve is like this. It's important to note that we're not talking about electronic crimes. It's electronic evidence
records
connected to everyday crimes. So 20 years ago, if you were a cop in Italy or Brazil or India, you never needed to leave your jurisdiction to get evidence connected to routine crimes like theft or kidnapping or bank robbery or murder. And that's just not true anymore. Is a billion of India's 1. Whatever it is, billion citizens have phones that have software that stores data outside of India's jurisdictional territory, right? So that's it's non-electronic crimes that have relevant electronic information that's stored abroad that we're talking about, and that number is just exploding. And so I think we agree that the process, if there's going to be revisions to the process, it has to address that explosion and growth of electronic evidence. How you define the scope of what's a part of that new regime is something that neither of us answer. That's a great question.
Yeah, the gentleman in the middle.
So you're saying the teacher used a hypo that made it simple and helped the teacher's point. I agree with that. I think you really do start with the easy one. It's when it's all German and then the US ECPA applies, you can see how there's a frustration from German law enforcement. So once you have that point, then you say something ought to be done. And then when you have a German victim and a French perpetrator, and they hid in Russia, they won't get it, but they hid in Italy. You know, within the EU, that happens all the time, and they haven't harmonized in the EU on legal procedures the way they have in a lot of other stuff. I don't feel like I have an answer to all of that right now, except to say you start with the easy ones. If you need to fix those, you start to work on the hard ones, and I don't pretend to have a global answer to everything. I am trying, as Andrew did, to shine more light on this area as something that we need to work on. And so come along and explain how to do the French stuff is what I'd say to that.
Helen.
so I think that's right. I mean, I just want to be clear. It's not, I mean, this is just a, it's a trope we often hear that the state has a right to data. The state doesn't have rights. So just as a slight aside, but I think, so it's not, so my argument about the Fourth Amendment is that if we're trying to protect the people, we need to begin to eliminate these territorial and identity-based distinctions because they're no longer adequately serving the people that we're trying to protect under the Fourth Amendment. And so therefore we need to have a notion of a Fourth Amendment that adequately protects the people that begins to eliminate some of these territorial and identity-based distinctions because they just don't work. I also think that ultimately whether or not a state gets access to data should not depend primarily or at least exclusively on where data is located. What that means and how we get there, I think we need to proceed carefully. And so I, as I said, I am nervous about the government's position in the Microsoft case because I think it has all kinds of costs and unintended consequences. At the end of the day, however, I don't think that our jurisdictional rules should depend exclusively on location of data. It doesn't make sense. It does not make sense in a world where data moves around, where data is held in multiple places. And in that way, I think we need to rethink how we think about when the government has and can and ought to be able to assert jurisdiction, and that shouldn't just depend on where data is actually physically located.
Do you have a question, Sam?
Could someone tell us a little bit about MLATs in the context of, let's say, China and the Russian Federation? I'm just curious about how the practice of MLATs has worked in that arena. And I think this also speaks to something that Doris was getting at earlier, which is that the MLAT issue is something that Andrew helped me clarify. The MLAT issue is really on its own trajectory from the surveillance issue. You can imagine robust MLAT cooperation, I guess hypothetically, anyway, in a world in which there was intense mutual surveillance going on between two countries. So I wonder if any of you could capture something of what an MLAT looks like in the context of Russia or China.
Doesn't exist. There is no such treaty. We don't have, I'm about 99% sure we don't have a treaty with either China or Russia. And there's been intense negotiations with India, but I don't know where it stands right now.
Not China, but we do have one with Russia.
We have one with Russia? Does anything ever work under it?
I don't know. Organized crime, presumably, but I'm wondering
if that's. Not sure.
China was a trick question.
I mean,
I forget I'm Brazil.
I think there is one with Brazil. Thanks. So I don't know the answer to the question, but let me answer a different question.
I think what there is that Peter's analogy of the visa waiver program already exists, which is to say the United States looks at the world and decides which countries it can trust their factual representations to then put in a court filing. Right, country A, the UK or France or now Russia, comes to the United States and says, hey, here are the 10 facts we know. Can you please put these facts into a court filing? And then based on that court filing, seek a search warrant or an ECPA order. So what happens before a treaty is negotiated is the US does a visa waiver type thing, looks at the world, says, who can we trust? And almost by definition, there are countries that the United States is unwilling to trust in that context, and some that it is. So it is a process that really only works when there is that pre-existing trust. And importantly, and I think this speaks to something Ira was saying before, the system is not really one where a judge in another country says, okay, I think it's okay under my law to search. Now bring this to the United States for execution. It is another country says, here are the facts. How do they work under the law of the place where the information is? So it's not a question of trusting or not trusting the local judicial officers. It's not a question of hewing or not hewing to local standards of privacy. It's a question of trusting those in the executive branch of the requesting country that gather up the facts and then convey it to the United States.
Which fortifies the question about surveillance.
Would
Yeah, so part of it is how do you actually make any of this happen? One thing you can do is go out and renegotiate 50 treaties or 80 treaties. It's hard, slow, won't get confirmed. Another is to try to see if you can pass one statute once in the United States, which doesn't require agreement abroad. And it's that's how the visa waiver program was done, one statute in the United States. And then the US, in its wisdom, decides who gets in that way. So you can actually imagine, at least conceivably, Congress passing a law someday once, and then you could do this thing. Whereas going and amending all the MLATs and doing the super nuanced MLAT treaty negotiation with every country in the world, it's much harder to imagine doing that.
But a follow-up question that I had that I think maybe also ties into what Kathy was getting at is, it seems like the current process, you're relying on other countries for facts, and then you're holding them to US standards, and US government agents are the actors in court doing that process. If we're going to lower the standard so there's a different standard for what applies to the US government and to another government trying to get evidence on our soil, are we also going to rely more on judicial process in other countries? And so they're not just representing facts to us, they're saying it's gone through a process in our
country. Almost never judicial process, though. It's almost always executive branch officials. And that's part of what the fuss is about, because you're not going to invent magistrates in countries that don't have them. And so how are we going to look at how the world is, which is with executive-based requests, and then assess that?
But some executive branch officials, so the process, simplified version of the process is, cop goes to cop's boss and says, we want this data from Google. Cop's boss says, absolutely, if that were in our territories, we would be able to get it according to our laws and standards. You ought to be able to get it from Google. So they pass it up the chain. It goes to their home office, and then it goes to their foreign secretary, and then it goes to our State Department sometimes, because literally these have been put in diplomatic bags, and then it's carried over to the OIA, the Office of International Affairs at DOJ, who then sends it to a U.S. lawyer in the Northern District of California, who then makes the case to in a court, right? Part of that process is fact-finding, but part of that process is squeezing those facts and framing them in a way that will satisfy the legal standard that the cop initially thought they had to satisfy because they weren't educated about the MLAT process. So it's the facts are stated in a way so as to satisfy a legal process in another country. And Michael's point, I think, is a really good one about trust, because trust is not only, it's an implicit element or sort of informal element. The Office of International Affairs has, I mean, lawyers there have told me that there have varying degrees of scrutiny that they apply when they get a request from someone they know really well, they've worked with them 1,000 times, they've never been lied to before, right? Or a new request from someone they don't know, who stated things clearly with some misunderstanding of how the process works, and who they may not trust, or who comes from a legal system that has that raises real questions about, for example, the adequacy of due process.
So we're at the end of our time, so maybe if anybody who has not yet asked a question can say their question, and then we can get a comment from the panel. Andy. Any other questions from someone who hasn't asked yet in the back?
Reciprocity.
Maybe in the break we'll do. Okay, what's your question too? All right, and any comments to close?
Just under oath varies by jurisdiction.
And reciprocity has partly been shaped in recent years by so much of the electronic evidence being in the U.S., so non-U.S. is coming for evidence here. Clearly, over time, more of the requests will be the U.S. going for evidence in other places, and we should be trying to build a system that will work on different ends. But the squeeze, the real pressure right now is U.S. evidence being sought from overseas.
Thank you very much.
What a pleasure to have someone else.